We are already 15 minutes late. And today, we come to focus on the cross of Calvary. We'll be focusing on the words that fell from the pallid or parched lips of Jesus from the cross. The words that were dropped by Jesus then must become ours today. And that should be our focus. And that is why we are here. Not to talk about what Jesus said and to go home saying that those were the words of Jesus. No. They should be our words. So we have to make those words our own. My dear friends, the death of our Lord Jesus Christ is a subject of never failing interest to all of us, not only the Christians, but the entire world. And his death remains a mystery of mysteries. And four words appear to sum up the salient features of this mystery. So firstly, the death of Christ was natural. Secondly, the death of Christ was unnatural. Thirdly, the death of Christ was preternatural. And fourthly, the death of Christ was supernatural. It was natural because it was natural. Absolutely natural. It was unnatural because it was abnormal. It was not natural. If death is the wage of sin, he did no sin, he had no sin, he knew no sin. And that's why it becomes unnatural. It becomes preternatural because it had already been marked, it had already been determined, predetermined for him beforehand. And it certainly becomes supernatural because his death was different from all other deaths. His birth was different, his life was different, so was his death. If I ask you a question as to why we are here, perhaps you might tell me is to focus on the crucifixion. Or if I ask you what is the significance of the crucifixion, perhaps you may say it is because of the killers who killed Jesus. Or you may say it's the pain that caused the death, or the scourging that caused the death. But my dear friends, it is pure love. It is pure love. So we are here to look at the love of Christ. Not the death of Christ, but the pure, unceasing, everlasting, unique love of Christ. And the challenge for all of us, as I told you at the very beginning, is to make these words our own words. Now please remember that. When you leave this church, you should be able to make the words that uttered by Jesus your own, my own, our own. So that's a bit of an introduction that I gave you. Shall we bow our heads and spend a few moments in silence? He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. Most merciful Father, as we are gathered together, Lord, as your people, chosen and handpicked by you, Lord, help us, Lord, to reflect on every word that was dropped by your Son while he was hanging on the cross. And may we make those words our own today. Amen. The first hymn, 84, hymn number 84, hymn number 84 in your hymnal. Please be seated.
The first reading is taken from the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 23, reading from verse 32 to 38. Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to a place called the Skull, they crucified him there, along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." There was written a notice above him which read, "This is the King of the Jews." Thanks be to God.
The first word of Jesus was to forgive his own killers. Is there anyone here who does not know what forgiveness is? Is there anybody here who has never forgiven your friends, your family members? Why not your enemies? Jesus, whose wounded body was stretched on that wooden heavy cross, was able to look at his executioners and say this, "Father, forgive them, for they not know what they do." Is he saying these words from a position of weakness? No, never. He is still the Creator. Is he who is hanging in pain silent? No, he is not silent. His pallid lips or his parched lips are seen to be moving. Is he crying for pity? No, he is not crying for pity. Is he pronouncing malediction upon his crucifiers? No, not at all. Jesus is praying. Jesus is praying. And his first of the seven words from the cross is a prayer. His public ministry was open with prayer. And we see his first word on the cross is a prayer. And it's a beautiful prayer, a meaningful prayer, a prayer of forgiveness, a prayer of forgiveness. Here, Jesus is preparing for his death. How do we prepare ourselves for our death? My dear friends, Jesus' hands can no longer minister to the sick because his hands are nailed. His feet can no longer move to nurse the poor as his feet are already nailed. He no longer can engage himself in instructing the apostles to go and minister to the others because the apostles are not around. They have forsaken him. They are scattered. But his ministry continues. His prayer ministry continues. His lips are at work. Not his hands, not his legs, but his lips are at work. What a great lesson, my dear friends. What a great lesson. We are shown here the efficacy of prayer, the strength of prayer. This cross intercession, or the intercession from the cross of Christ for his enemies, gave definite answers. We saw the conversion of 3,000 odd people at the time of the Pentecost. That Christ should make intercession for his enemies was a prophecy found in Isaiah 53. So here we see the fulfillment of the prophecy. Then we also see Jesus identifying himself with his people, because Jesus had never made such a request from his heavenly Father when he was doing his ministry on earth. He never asked his Father to forgive someone. He forgave. But have you ever wondered why Jesus had to ask his Father to forgive someone? Now there is a interpretation by some theologians. You see, forgiveness of sin is a divine prerogative. And the Jewish scribes one day asked, who can forgive sins but only God? Jesus was 100% God, 100% man. And when Jesus cried, Father, forgive them, he was on the cross, and from the cross, he could not exercise his divine prerogative. In Matthew 9:6, we read that says, the Son of Man had power on earth to forgive sins. But my dear friends, he was no longer on earth. He had been lifted up from the earth. So he was no longer in the place of authority to exercise his own prerogative. Then he shouted and said, Father, forgive them. By saying that, by doing that, Jesus taught us to forgive others. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. This means forgive us our sins in preparation as we forgive those who have sinned against us. My dear friends, if we are to have this Christian forgiveness in our lives, three things are absolutely necessary. We must learn to understand. Firstly, there is always a reason why a person does something wrong. Secondly, we must learn to forget. Sometimes we are ready to forgive, but we are not ready to forget. Thirdly, we must learn to love. And that is something which is sadly missing in our midst. Let me share with you a story. One day, a man was dying. But before his death, he wanted to make a confession. And he thought to himself that dying without confession was not good. And so he was determined to share with someone what he had in his mind, in his thoughts, and he wanted to say sorry. And so he called the priest and he said, Father, please come. I want to share something with you. And the priest went to him and he was listening to his story. It was during the Christmas season. He was working at the railway station to put the gates down and to operate the switch. One day after a party, he was fully drunk. He went to his station. He operated the machine, came back home and slept. The following day, there was a banner headline which said, 5 people who were traveling in a vehicle were crushed by the running train. One survived. And this priest was listening to him, and This person said, "Father, I operated the wrong switch. I pressed the wrong switch because I was drunk. And so the death of 4 members in the family is because of me. Will God forgive me?" He was very upset. He had been tortured by this feeling. And this priest did not know what to do. This priest ran short of words. The priest was looking into his eyes for a long time. There was a long pause. And the priest said, "I forgive you. I'm the one who survived." The priest was going with his wife and children, and he lost his wife and precious children. My dear friends, we are in a world where we cannot forgive others. It becomes a very difficult thing for us to forgive others. We find it very difficult to forgive our own wives and children. Children don't forgive their parents. We don't forgive our neighbors. We cannot forgive our enemies. And here, the Lord, from the cross, he says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not. For they know not what they do." Now, what is he trying to say here? The killers, the soldiers knew that if someone is crucified, that person will die. We all know that if you stab someone, shoot someone, you can kill them. Now, Jesus is talking about something different. He's talking about the enormity of that sin. The people who crucified Jesus did not understand the enormity of the sin. And that's what is happening in our own land. Many people are eliminated. You can get rid of anyone. But they know that if you shoot someone, if you kill someone, it is a sin. They don't understand the enormity of that sin. My dear friends, we have to be very, very careful. We have to be extremely careful. Causing pain to someone. It can be your own wife. It can be your own child. It can be your own friend. We know that when we cause pain, it hurts. We also should know the enormity of that sin, of that pain. Let us bow our heads, be in an attitude of prayer. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. Do you really believe God has forgiven your sins? Do you take time on a regular basis to confess your sins so that you might enjoy the freedom of forgiveness? Do you need to experience God's forgiveness in a fresh way today? Commit yourselves to the Lord. Loving Father, though I believe at one level that you have forgiven me, this amazing truth needs to penetrate my heart in new ways. Help me to know with fresh conviction that I am fully and finally forgiven, not because of anything I have done, but because of what you have done for me. Amen. The second hymn, hymn number 200.
Thank you. Please be seated.
The second reading is taken from Luke chapter 23, verses 39 to 43. One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God?" he said. "Since you are under the same sentence, we are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "I tell you the truth. Today you will be with me in paradise." Thanks be to God.
What a wonderful thing to have this little child. Praise the Lord. Therefore you cannot sleep. What a blessing to have children. Beautiful voice. And I saw him counting 1, 2, 3, 4, and then said, "This is the word of the Lord." Well trained. The first verse, the first utterance of Jesus was the word of forgiveness. That was the word of forgiveness. Here we see another different story. The second word, which is known as the word of salvation, is in response to the request of the dying thief. Firstly, remember, it was no accident that the Lord of glory was crucified between two thieves. But 700 years before this, Roman officer Pilate gave his command for Jesus to be crucified. God had declared through Isaiah that his son should be numbered with the transgressors. So we see the Holy One with the unholy according to the prophecy. And let us take our lessons from the thieves today. How come both are thieves? Jesus is flanked by thieves. Both have done many wrong things in their lives. How come one is able to look at Jesus and identify Jesus as the Savior, but one is not able to do so? So one is receiving salvation while the other is not. My dear friends, the thieves were with the same mindset. Perhaps they may have committed many wrong things together. They may be guilty of doing something wrong. And as we are seated, we represent the thieves. One was able to be receptive to the gospel, while the other was not. All who are here are as sinners. But when the seeds are sown, seeds fall on many grounds, some on thorny areas, some on the wayside. But the seeds are sown. The gospel is preached. The word of God is shared. But how come only few are receptive to the word of God, the truth? So when the gospel is revealed to some, the gospel is concealed or hidden to many. And that is a problem. And that is a big problem. Have you ever given thought to that problem? The same word of God is preached. The same seeds are sown. But a few learn from the gospel. Few are able to bring about a change, transformation of their lives, but not all. I'm not talking about outside the gate. We don't have to go out. When I take examples, I take from myself. It starts with me. It starts with me and my family. So let us, who are here seated as sinners, as friends of Christ, think about it. So one sinner is able to look at Jesus and say, look here, you are the Christ. You can do something. My dear friends, this is a classic example of forgiveness through repentance. And if we want forgiveness, we must repent. God in His mercy can offer a blanket forgiveness to all men. But this will never happen. Because, as I told you, few are receptive to the gospel while the others are not. So the thief sees Jesus only when he is weak. He is not able to see the power of or strength of Jesus. The one who is ridiculing Jesus is looking at Jesus only when he is weak. He is not able to, he has not understood the power of Jesus. Maybe he saw Jesus for the first time. So it is believed that this thief may not have followed Jesus, the one who ridiculed Jesus. But the one who was able to look at Jesus and identify Jesus as his Savior may not have also followed Jesus. Let us assume that he has not followed Jesus. Probably he may have seen the board on the head of Jesus. Probably he may have seen the people crying, wailing, weeping. Probably he may have heard some people whispering. I visited a dying person some time ago. When the wife called me and said, Father, please come home, my husband is dying. I always go prepared with the sacrament. And I went there and I asked this man who was almost dying, I said, can I give you communion? He said, no. I said, it's okay. I am not prepared. And the wife was in tears. Wife was in tears. For me, as a priest, I was also a little upset because, you see, even at the dying moment, many people have come to know who Christ is. But here, the thief knows what crucifixion is. He has seen many crucifixions before, but he is not able to identify Jesus as his Savior, as Lord, as his Master, God. He's ridiculing Jesus. But the other thief is opening his heart to Jesus. What a demonstration of human depravity. My dear friends, by nature, there is the same depravity inhering within us. Even from the deathbed, many people can't forgive, can't accept Christ. We have to be very careful, especially teaching the children to be receptive to the gospel. There'll be a time when you may not be able to kneel down and pray, you might have to run. Therefore, we should be able to identify who our Christ is. There was a woman who died of alcoholic cirrhosis. So in a letter before she died, she blamed almost everybody for this. He said, because of that one I became an alcoholic, because of this one I became an alcoholic. I mean, we do that. I mean, when we are into all this, we mess up with the life. He said, because of that batch, I am like this. Because of that crowd, I am like this. But there was a nun who used to visit the prisons, and she made the prisoners on death row to admit their own sin before they are killed. My dear friends, sometimes we ourselves are not able to identify our Christ. But here, this man who also was hanging on the cross as a thief, he realized his own sinfulness, and here he is able to seek forgiveness. So his hands that were used to do immoral and evil things, and his feet that ran to do the same wrong things, are nailed. He cannot do anything. Our hands and legs are also nailed to the cross. Perhaps we will see Jesus better through our heart. Like the prodigal son, this thief never blamed anyone. He acknowledged his sinfulness. He acknowledged that he was a sinner, and God loves self-confessed sinners. And his prayer was a humble prayer, and it was not, Lord, honor me, or Lord, exalt me, but it was, Lord, remember me. And there are certain things that we need to look at from this amazing conversion. Jesus never opened the scripture and preached to this man, but there was a conversion. And I tell you, my dear friends, conversion is not by someone to someone else. Sometimes we misunderstand the meaning of conversion. Conversion is through conviction. So here is a man who, through his conviction, is able to be converted. First, he expresses his belief in a future life where retribution would be meted out by a righteous and sin-avenging God. He realized that his future life was only going to be with the Lord. So he is able to reflect. While I talk to you, are you able to reflect on the word? Are you able to reflect? While hanging on the cross, so he was reflecting. Secondly, he had a sight of his own sinfulness. He was able to realize that, look here, I am here because of what I did. Here is someone is here who is here because for what he did not do. So we also should be able to reflect on our own life, my dear friends. And thirdly, he bore testimony to Christ's sinlessness. He said, this man has not done anything, but I have done something, so I deserve this. And fourthly, becoming a witness to the sinless humanity of Christ, he prays that humble prayer, Lord, remember me. What a way to humble himself. What a way to humble ourselves. And fifthly, he believed in the saviorhood of the Lord Jesus. He heard the first prayer of Jesus from the cross. Probably even though he heard the first prayer, he heard the first prayer of Jesus. Jesus said, forgive them. So probably he would have learned his lesson, which the other thief could not learn. So my dear friends, we may be all seated together in under one roof, but what do we hear and what do we learn? And when he cried, remember me, what he meant was, save me, save me. This is what the people said, Hosanna, when Jesus entered triumphantly into his own city, Jerusalem. He evidenced his faith in Christ's kingship. He said, remember me when you come into your kingdom. What an amazing faith and knowledge, my dear friends. He saw Jesus as the King of Kings. And finally, he looked forward to the second coming of Christ. He said, when you come, remember me. He knew about the second coming of Christ. My dear friends, a prayer of this contrite, remorseful, believing thief was taken up, was considered to be good by Jesus. And this is the climax of grace and the sum of Christian blessing. What should be our prayer? What should be our prayer? When we go to, before we go to bed, can we say, Lord, remember me. I am a sinner. I have sinned against my own people. I have sinned against my own nation, my own community. Forgive me and remember me. Let us be silent for a while. I assure you, today you will be with me in paradise. Have you asked your life on Jesus? Have you put your ultimate trust in him? Do you know that when your time comes, you will be with him in paradise? Lord Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me today as I seek to live within your kingdom. Amen. Hymn number 13. Hymn number 13, 1-3.
shanty came, so the mournful bother came, close to Jesus at the sins in anguish, there she saw the victim languish, bleeding torments bleed and die. So the Lord took one of him, who gathered in death forsaken.
Please be seated.
The third reading is taken from the book of John, reading from chapter 19, Reading from verses 25 to 27. Jesus' mother stood beside his cross with her sister and Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and his favorite disciple he loved with her, he said to his mother, "This man now is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "She is now your mother." From then on, that disciple took her into his own home. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
From the word of salvation, we move to the word of promise. Here we see a very sad, pathetic scene. Can you imagine your own child, your own husband, your own wife being beaten in front of you? Have you ever come across that in your personal life? It's rather excruciating, very painful. And a sword will pierce your own soul. Luke 2:35. This was the song of Simeon when he saw baby Jesus in the temple. And here, when Mary was standing in front of her dying son, yes, the sword was piercing her soul. She was the biological mother of Jesus. What anguish she may have gone through when she learned of Herod's idea to destroy her son at the very beginning. Even at the very beginning, she had to run away, taking the child, protecting the child. And what trouble she may have gone through when she had to flee with her infant baby to Egypt due to threats of life. Have you ever run away, run for your life? Anybody? Coming under threat, you have to run for your life. It's very, very painful, very difficult. What can I say? That experience cannot be shared. If you have to run for your life, it's a terrible experience. If you have experienced, you can share. If you think you can share, it's good. Otherwise, it's very, very painful. And this couple, Joseph and Mary, experienced that. And this child was born without any physical intimacy with her husband. And this child was very, very special to Mother Mary. And now what pain she would have gone through to see her own son on the cross. And she knew how this child was born. And this child was conceived by the Holy Spirit. So this child, Jesus, was so precious, so special. Because from the very beginning, this mother knew that this child will be a savior. We do not know what our children would become in the future. One day, I was walking when my son was very, very small, tiny, and I met a diplomat, retired. He said, he looked at the small fellow and said, how are you? What would you do when you become big? He said, I want to be a priest. This diplomat was shocked. He said, I've never heard any child smaller than this little boy. But now go and ask him. The answer will be completely different. We do not know what they have in their minds. But this mother knew that her child would be the savior. And Gabriel, who brought the news of the miraculous conception, never did say at that time that her son would be crucified. So when Jesus was bleeding, when every drop of blood from his body fell on the ground, she would have thought of the infant Jesus being fed by her own blood. Probably she would have thought, my gosh, look at this, my own son bleeding, my blood. She had two options. As a mother, she had two options. She either to take the son and run away, or to stand there and face persecution. What would you do? What would you do? If your own loved one is suffering in pain, you take that person and run away, or stand there and watch? And here, Mother Mary did not run away, but she stood there willing to face the persecution. Where were the disciples? They ran away. But here, the mother is willing to be persecuted. Probably they could have killed her. She was strong enough to stand by her son. Now, Jesus could not see his own mother properly as sweat and blood covered his eyes. To Mother Mary, that bloody scene was horrible. However, Jesus managed to look at her weeping, to look at this weeping woman, weeping mother. And his heart would have been broken. You know, we know how our little children, how they move with us. They're so friendly, so loving. We cuddle them, we hug them, we kiss them. Mother Mary did all those, feeding, breastfeeding. And then Jesus would have really felt sorry. So if Christ was the man of sorrows, so was his mother, who was the woman of sorrows. His disciples deserted him, and his friends forsake him, but his mother stands at the foot of the cross. My dear friends, certainly this brings to the fulfillment of Simeon's prophecy. Simeon in the temple did say so. So far as the record of the fourth gospel goes, never once did he call her mother. Jesus always called his mother woman in public. When he saw his weeping mother, the mother in sorrow, he also saw his beloved disciples, John. All the other disciples were not to be seen. And as Mary was also standing there helplessly, he looked at Mary and said, "Woman, here is your son." And he looked at John and said, "Here is your mother." Well, this scene was one of the most moving scenes, which demonstrated a son's concern for his mother. "Despise not thy mother when she is old," Proverbs 23:22. Sometimes I visit the elders' homes, and they tell me, holding my hands, said, "Father, our children are not calling us. Our children are not visiting us. Can you please give my number? My child lives very close by, very, very close. Can you give my number and ask my child to call me? It breaks my hand." And the commandment says, "Honor thy father and mother." So Jesus was a good son. Having said this, my dear friends, I also must remind you of another school of thought. Why was not Mary entrusted to Jesus's young brothers? They would have been there. But why this disciple? It is with them that she appears after the resurrection. She appeared after resurrection with his other brothers. But how come Jesus is entrusting, is looking at this, the disciple, and says, here is your mother? Sometimes taking the scripture at the face value can be a mistake. Let us look at this way, which gives a real theological interpretation. Though Jesus had a family, the real family of Jesus were those who followed him. When his brothers and brothers came and sisters came, he said, no, my brothers, my sisters are the ones who follow me. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother. Mark 3:35. And a man wanted to follow Jesus, but the day he wanted to follow Jesus, his father died. And what did Jesus say? Let the dead bury the dead. So in other words, even saying goodbye to our families was forbidden. In following Jesus, there was no room for sentimentality, my dear friends. So given that context, do you think Jesus would have handed over his mother to his disciple, considering a widowhood? No doubt he loved and cared for his mother, but his definition of mother is different, as we saw it earlier. He said, whoever who follows me is my brother, is my sister, is my mother. And let us look at the life of Mary. As a Jewish girl, Mary gave birth to Christianity. However, she was a woman of the Old Testament. She was a woman of Judaism. And Christianity was rooted in Judaism. So what Jesus is doing here is, from the cross, he is introducing the old to the new. This is an indication that the old covenant has given way to the new. So Mary, as the representative of the old faith, is entrusted by Jesus to the representative of the new, the beloved disciple John. So the old is meeting the new. So there is a continuation of the old and the new. And if you are reading the Bible, read also the Old Testament, not only the New Testament. If you only knew the New Testament, you will not know the full Bible. New Testament is the continuation of the Old Testament, or the First Testament, we call it. So here, Jesus is bringing a woman of the Old Testament and connecting that old to the new. So there is a kind of a bond. And this incident complements the story of the first miracle at wedding in Cana. And John tells how water used for Jewish purification rites is transformed into the new wine of the gospel, thereby indicating that the old covenant has given way to the new. I'll end with a story. There is a story about Professor Benjamin Warfield. He was a professor of theology and at Princeton University. Dr. Warfield traveled to Germany with his newly married wife. The couple was hiking on top of a mountain when his wife was struck down by lightning and became invalid. So he started to take care of his wife. And his whole life was to, he spent his whole life caring for his wife. One day, somebody had come and met him and said, It's good that you're looking after your wife, but sir, why didn't you start writing again? You've been a great writer, written many books. You've been a great preacher, doing ministry. And he said, why don't you start to write books again? We are waiting. The world is waiting to see your writing. And they said, the world is waiting to see your ministry. So Professor Benjamin had told him, my dear friend, no way. I will not get back to my writing or my profession because my wife is my ministry. Now, who is the bride and who is the bridegroom? If the church is the bride, Christ is the bridegroom. True enough, Jesus cared for his mother, but he is more concerned about the church built on his foundation. My dear friends, when the old is being introduced to the new, we become that new. We become the people of that new covenant. And it is your duty and it is my duty to move into the world with that new covenant, taking the word of God to the world. So as Jesus connected his own mother to his own disciple, there was a great meaning. As we are the people of the new covenant, let us resolve to take the word to the world. Let us spend a few moments in silence. What does Mary's presence at the cross evoke you? Why do you think was it necessary for Jesus to suffer physical pain as he died? Why do you think Jesus handed over his mother of the Old Testament to his disciple of the New? Let us ask ourselves this question. O Lord, how can I begin to thank you for what you suffered? My words fall short. My thoughts seem superficial and vague. Nevertheless, I offer my sincere gratitude for your suffering. Thank you for bearing my sin on the cross. I give you my praise, my love, my heart, all that I am, because you have given me all that you are. Let us sing our next hymn, hymn number 347, 347.
King of Revival.
watch with thee. Darkness veils thine anguished face.
Please be seated.
The fourth reading is taken from the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 27, reading from verses 45 to 47. Now from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, there was darkness over all the land. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Some of those who stood there, when they heard that, said, this man is calling for Elijah. Thanks be to God.
Another child. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. We focused on the word of promise and we move to the word of anguish. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? It is a lament. If you go through Psalm 22, which is known as a lament psalm, the psalm full of cries for help and expressions of grief and despair. And he was experiencing the full weight of God's wrath against sin. When Jesus took the sins of the world upon himself, he bore the punishment that we deserve. This punishment included separation from God. Jesus had never been separated from God before. So this must have been an excruciating experience for him. He was fulfilling the prophecies of the Old Testament. Psalm 22 is a messianic psalm, which means it prophesies about the coming Messiah. This is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. This was the certificate of honor that was given to Jesus during his baptism. If God's son Jesus was the most favorite of the heaven and of our heavenly father, how come God should deliver him up to such a shameful death? This can be a question that we may raise. So these words were of appalling woe. The very word forsaken is one of the most tragic in all human speech, I must say. We have heard of a forsaken city. We have heard of a forsaken community, forsaken wives, forsaken children, families, parents, and this is very, very common. But God forsaking Jesus is not something that we can believe. Jesus, from the very inception, has been enjoying an unbroken communion with his Father. But what then must it have meant to be forsaken now by God the Creator? So these are words of deepest mystery. Down the ages, Jehovah has never forsaken his people. He was their refuge in times of trouble. When the Israelites were in bondage, they cried unto the Lord, and he heard their cry. And they came up to the Red Sea, he delivered them from the enemies. And when the three Hebrew friends were thrown into the fiery furnace, the Lord was with them. But here, when Jesus is at the cross, there is no response whatsoever from above. And so Jesus, in anguish, shouts, "My God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" What a personal note. First time, Jesus is talking about himself. Let us see why Jesus is saying this. There are different kinds of death, and they are natural and unnatural. When Adam destroyed his own spiritual life, it took the form of suicide. When Cain killed his brother, it took the form of fratricide. When men tried to kill Jesus, it took the form of deicide. The Bible says, the wages of sin is death. I mean spiritual death. But Jesus had no sin, knew no sin, did no sin. And as I said at the very beginning, if the wages of sin is spiritual death, we can't bring any comparison here between Jesus and death. But still, Jesus was feeling the weight of sin. Whose sin? Our own sin. That was the weight of the sin. Now on the cross, the Lord Jesus was receiving the wages that were due his people. He had no sin of his own, for he was the Holy One of God. But he was holding our sins in his own body on the tree. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, the scripture says. So my dear friends, Jesus on the cross took our place and was suffering. The just for the unjust. And this meant separation from God. And this prompted him to cry, look up to his father and say, Father, God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus has suffered from the very beginning. From the earliest infancy, he had suffered from man. From the very beginning of his public ministry, he suffered from Satan. In the Garden of Gethsemane, when he suffered, he was left all alone. So we see Jesus has suffered from the very beginning, right along all by himself. And he shared our suffering, but nobody was there to share his suffering. I'm sure we have made this word our own many times. Sometimes it is easy to trust God when the sun is shining. But the test comes when all is dark. When we can't get through our exams, we say, Lord, Lord, where are you? Or when we fail to do something, we say, Lord, why have you left us? Why have you forsaken us? And this cry also comes from many parents. When their children are, say, not married, not been able to find good employment, jobs, or go the wrong way, or when there are problems, we do cry, say, Lord, Lord, where are you? Why have you forsaken us? Have you felt forsaken by God, my dear friends? Many people have felt forsaken, abandoned, and betrayed by those who love them. And such people have asked this question, where is God? A very young woman called me about a month ago. She said, Father, are you sure God is true? Are you sure God is alive? Very sadly, this young woman got married, but in 2 months they were separated. And they had to go, they went through a difficult patch in their lives. So many sessions of counseling did not help. They went their own way. And this was the question that was raised to me just about 3 weeks ago. So, Father, are you sure? Father, are you sure? Is God living? My dear friends, today, many people are asking this question. Many Christians are asking these questions. If you visit the refugee camps, homes, elders' homes, or even hospitals, We must be in the habit of visiting hospitals, prisons, police custodies. People will ask the same question. Why is that we are left alone by God? Why is that God is not answering our prayer? Have you come across this, my dear friends? This word becomes our own word. But the difference between our cry and the cry of Jesus is that Jesus' feeling of forsakenness was due to the sin of others. In other words, he was bearing our own sins. But when we cry, we bear our own sins. Now, one example is that this couple did not cooperate, didn't want to come for counseling, did not take proper advice. So we suffer because of our own sinful nature, because of our own sins. And then we cry, Lord, where are you? Why have you forsaken us? Why are you not doing this? Nevertheless, the feeling is horrible. It is devastating when we feel that we are let down. My dear friends, as I talk to you right now, try not to forsake another. It's a terrible thing to do. It is so painful. If there is anybody here or outside planning to move away from the families, move away from your wives and husbands, and if children are planning to move away from the parents, please don't. Tell them to change their minds. That pain is excruciating. Is there anybody planning to abandon friendship? Please don't. That pain is quite heavy. So the feeling of abandonment, of forsakenness, is too painful. Jesus felt the same pain, not because of his sinfulness, but because of somebody else's sins. So in our day-to-day life, we too use the same words uttered by Jesus many times. Not only the Christians. You go out, people question our own God. They say, where is your God? We are suffering. We are in pain. But where is God? My dear friends, you and I cry and say the same prayer because of our sins. But Lord Jesus, he said it for a different reason. Nevertheless, having said that, I say today, the feeling of abandonment, of forsakenness is too painful. Too painful. And if you see people are separated, if communities are not together, bring them together. That is our calling. That is the gospel. To bring the broken, fractured hearts, fractured communities together. Let us spend a few moments in silence. my God, why have you abandoned me? Have you taken time to consider that Jesus was abandoned by the Father so that you might not be? What does this word from the cross mean to you? Though we listen to the word of Jesus, we will not fully grasp the wonder and horror of our abandonment, as the weight of forsakenness is too much. Let us not forsake another for whatever reason. Amen. Let us sing our next hymn, 130, in your hymnal book.
His other thoughts on sparkling rays that from a thousand far fountains burst and filled with music all the hills, and yet he said,
please be seated.
The fifth reading is taken from the book of St. John, Chapter 19, verses 28 to 29. The death of Jesus. Later, knowing that everything had now been finished, and so that the scriptures would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there. So they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of hyssop plant and lifted it to Jesus' lips. Thanks be to God.
From the word of anguish, we now move to the word of suffering. I thirst. These words were spoken by the suffering Savior shortly before he gave up his spirit. Before we move forward, I just want to share with you the prophetic words of God coming true, which I think it's amazing. Every important detail of the great tragedy had been written down beforehand. I'll go through a list, a small list. The betrayal by a familiar friend, Psalm 41:9. The forsaking of the disciples, Psalm 31:11. The false accusation, Psalm 35:11. The silence before his judges, Isaiah 53:7. The being proven guiltless, Isaiah 53:9. Jesus with his transgressors, Isaiah 53:12. Being crucified, Psalm 22:16. The mockery of the spectators, Psalm 109:25. The gambling for his garments, Psalm 22:18. The prayer for his enemies, Isaiah 53:12. Being forsaken by God, Psalm 22:1. The thirsting, Psalm 69:21. Yielding of his spirit to the Father, Psalm 31:5. Bones not broken, Psalm 34:20. Burial in a rich man's tomb, Isaiah 53:9. So, my dear friends, everything had been foretold and pre-written centuries before they came to pass. Yes, here we have the evidence of Christ's humanity. Jesus was very God of very God, but he was also very man of very man. He was 100% God, 100% human. He was forever God and forever man. How many of us have a thirst for something in life? We thirst for love, we thirst for care, we thirst for protection, we thirst for prestige, we thirst for power and position, we thirst for lust, liquor and pleasure. Yes, we too thirst in life. We also have our own thirst. And our thirst can lead us to either a righteous life or an unrighteous life or an immoral life, depending on the kind of thirst we have within us. We have our thirst. Jesus had his thirst. When we have our thirst, either we go the good way or we can go the wrong way. Sometimes when people have the thirst of power, they also have the thirst for blood. And they can go on eliminating people in order to be in power. We have seen this, people thirsting for power, thirsting for positions, can go down, stoop down to any level in order to quench their thirst. They are bloodthirsty people, we call them. Who is interested in somebody else's blood? Not God. In the good old days, it was thought that God loved blood, and that is why sacrifices were made. But God proved that he is not a God for blood. When Isaac was laid on the altar, and when his father was about to sacrifice him, what was the answer? Our God is not a God who wants to see human blood shed. And this is why our Lord, our Savior, shed his own blood, and in order to show the world, look here, don't shed blood. When the evil wanted this one man's blood, assuming this will lead to the ultimate death of this person, God gives him life again on the third day and brings him out of the grave. The grave could not contain, the grave could not hold this man. My dear friends, what are we thirsty for? Are we thirsty for the word of God? Have you ever examined the kind of thirst that we have? When we reject our Savior, and if we die, our eternal cry also will be the same. I thirst. I thirst. This is the moan of the damned. My dear friends, in the lake of fire, the lost, in other words, those who have either rejected the gospel or pretend not to hear the gospel, will suffer amid the flames of God's wrath forever and ever. And it is at that time also we will be thirsty. Do you remember the story of the rich man? He looks at Abraham and he says, Lord, make that man Lazarus to dip his fingers in water so that I would be quenched, because he is in need of water. He wants him to cool his tongue. He's tormented in this flame. If the physical thirst can be unbearable, then how about the thirst in the lake of fire? My dear friends, I'm not trying to frighten you. God has taken away our sins. God has forgiven us. But still, are we receptive to the gospel? We have different types of thirst. So we need to ask ourselves, what type of thirst that we as Christians, as followers of Christ, can have? Do you remember the story when Jesus met this woman at the well? When Jesus met this woman, the Samaritan woman at the well, he said, I'm thirsty. And this woman was totally prepared to give Jesus water. Did she give water? Did Jesus drink that water? We know the story. Jesus never drank that water that was offered to him by this woman. But Jesus had a different type of a thirst, which this woman did not understand or could not understand. He had a different type of a thirst. But he quenched his thirst from the faith and salvation of that Samaritan woman. Salvation refreshed his heart. Now in the story, it's a very interesting story. The disciples go out to fetch something for Jesus. They thought Jesus is hungry and thirsty. But when the disciples brought with them food to offer Jesus, did he eat that food? No. Jesus never drank that water. Jesus never ate that food. But he did say, I'm hungry, I'm thirsty. The moment he saw the transformation in the life of that Samaritan woman, his thirst was quenched, his stomach was filled. So here, my dear friends, Jesus says, I thirst. And the people who were watching him thought he was really thirsty, and they tried to give him something to drink, and he refused. Before Jesus met us, yes, he was thirsty and hungry. After meeting us, the question that we need to ask is whether Jesus is still thirsty or hungry for my soul. For my soul. My dear friends, what should be then our thirst on earth? We have our thirst, different types of thirst. It varies. Students, children, adults, married, couples, professionals, we have our different types of thirst. But as I mentioned, some of our thirsts can take us to a wrong way. Some of our thirsts can take us, put us in the right way. As Jesus was thirsty for our souls, can we ask that question whether he is still thirsty for our souls? Sometimes we may call ourselves Christians. We may hold a board and saying that we are members of this church or that church. And we are proud to call ourselves that we are members of this parish, that parish. We are office bearers. We have been pillars. One day I was at another church. An old lady came and said, Father, you are new to this place. I have been a pillar of the church. I was wondering what type of pillar that could be. Bricks? Stones? Sand? Jesus hates such pillars. He looked at those pillars. He looked at that temple and said, I will bring this down. My dear friends, these pillars can be broken down. Very easy. Very easy. You may need, with hard work, maybe one day, 2 days. But can this pillar be brought down? Never. And it should never be so. Jesus is thirsty for such a soul. What is our thirst? Our thirst should be for the Word of God. Word of God. Very sadly, Sunday school Children don't come to the Sunday school. They go for other classes. They go for so many other activities. Youth fellowship, men's guild, mothers' union, whatever the union you may call it. Thank God there's no trade union here. We must have the thirst for the word of God, and that is fundamental. No one can deny that. No one can deny that. And that same Jesus says the same thing today. I thirst. I thirst. You and I have a huge responsibility to quench the thirst of our Lord Jesus. Jesus connected the old with the new, as I told you earlier. And that is our responsibility. We are the people of the new covenant. It's you and I who should quench the thirst of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's spend a few moments in silence. How would you respond to that statement of our Lord Jesus, I am thirsty? And what does this statement suggest to you about Jesus and about yourself? Lord Jesus, in your own words, I am thirsty. I hear the cry of my own heart. I too am thirsty, Lord, not for physical drink. Rather, I need the new drink of your kingdom to flood my soul. I yearn for your spirit to fill me once again. Let us stand and sing our next hymn, 344. 344.
There's a green hill far over, without a city wall, where the dear Lord was crucified, who died to save us all. We may not know, we cannot tell, what pain she had to bear. But we believe it was for us. He hung and suffered there. He died that we might be forgiven. He died to make us good, that we might go at last to heaven, saved by his precious blood. There was no other good enough to pray the price of sin. He only could unlock the gate of heaven and let us in. Glory, 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 glory.
Please be seated.
The Bible reading is taken from John chapter 19, verse 30. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Thanks be to God.
From the word of suffering, we move to the word of victory. It is a victorious, a triumphant statement. It is finished. The last two words of Jesus have been occupied with the tragedy of the cross. We now shall turn to its triumph. In the last word, "I thirst," we heard our Lord's cry of lamentation. But now we hear the cry of jubilation. The word "finished" may sound to us as one word, but in that word is wrapped up the entire gospel of God. The word was the declaration that all for which he came from heaven to earth to do was now done. What was finished? His sacrificial work was complete. That he will be born in Bethlehem was fulfilled. That someone will go before Christ to prepare the way was fulfilled. Prophecy about his degradation, crucifixion, and even his resurrection was fulfilled. The prophecy concerning his first coming was completed. And now we have to wait for the second coming according to the same prophecy, which is yet to come. So, my dear friends, when Jesus said, "It is finished," it was a triumphant statement. There was a carpenter who made a gate for a farmer who was in need of a gate. The farmer was sad about the unsaved carpenter. Both were friends. Farmer needs a gate, a wooden gate. He's also sad about the unsaved carpenter. So he goes to his friend and says, "My dear friend, I want a gate, a wooden gate." But before that, he tried his level best to explain to the carpenter of Christ's salvation. But the carpenter did not pay heed. The carpenter did not understand. One day, the farmer came and told this friend, he said, "I want a wooden gate." And he said, "Okay." And the gate was done. And he took it home and fixed this beautiful gate. Nicely done, nicely, lovely, beautiful painted gate. And the following day, the farmer invited the carpenter to see the newly fixed gate. He said, "Come and see the beauty of this gate. It's a beautiful piece of work." When the carpenter arrived, the carpenter was shocked to see this farmer standing with an axe in his hand. The carpenter asked, "My friend, you invited me to show the gate that I made. What are you carrying this axe for?" So, this farmer had said, "Look here, I need to make some chopping, some cutting because I need to finish it. So the carpenter was very hurt. He said, my dear friend, it is a finished product. It is already finished. And he was a well-known carpenter. But to his utter dismay, this farmer went, took the axe, chopped the gate, and the carpenter was in pain. And the carpenter cried. He said, come on, my dear friend, I took such a long time, so much of labor, hard work, what are you doing? He said, my dear friend, carpenter friend, this is what I tried to tell you about Christ. You did not understand. This is how we feel. When something is finished, we do not know, we don't realize that it is finished. John 5:36 says, for the very work that the Father has given me to finish and which I am doing testifies that the Father has sent me. So Jesus was sent on a very special mission. So the mission upon which God had sent his Son to the world was now accomplished. Are we able to say it is finished by fulfilling the aspirations of God? Can we say to our children that our work as parents is finished? The very famous quote of Saint Paul to the young Timothy, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. We normally use these for funerals. When Paul said, I have fought the good fight, it was perseverance and continuing even when the road is hard. Who can say that I have fought the good fight? Who can say that I have run the good race and I have kept the faith? Jesus was able to say this. And that is why it was a triumphant statement. Can we say the same word? Sometimes we are unable to say it is finished because it is not finished. What is our calling? What is our mission on earth? And can we say the same thing one day to our children? Children, it is finished. I have done my part. Can the children say this to the same thing to their parents? Can our leaders say this today? It is finished. We have done our job well. We came here for a purpose. You made us leaders. It is finished. How can we say it is finished without even starting it? Sometimes we don't even start. We have not even started our journey. Sometimes I feel a little odd. Pardon my saying this, don't misunderstand me. I feel a little odd to address a Christian gathering. Why should I do that? As if you don't know the scripture. As if you have never gone to the Sunday schools. But our calling is to do it over and over again because we are not even started. We are not even come to the starting point. How many Bible studies? How many lectures? How many sermons? And sometimes when we hear some of the stories of people, even in their latter stage, it really, the stories break our hearts. It's not that they have not heard the sermons or studied the scripture or gone through the scripture. I do not know, then what? Have we started our Christian journey, or are we still at the starting point waiting for the word go? When we are supposed to be in our pilgrimage, how many of us are still finding the way to go? How many people who are dying can say it is finished? Some people can't even say it is finished because there's so much of guilt. Many things are left behind. So, my dear friends, in our earthly life, we humans face all sorts of problems. Though Jesus was able to say this, he expects all of us to say the same thing. Jesus was sent for a particular reason, and he fulfilled, he accomplished his task. He never violated anything. Nothing was left behind. Nothing was left undone. Having completed everything, he could say that it is finished. My dear friends, as I told you, have we started our Christian journey? If we have not started our Christian journey, this is the time. Are we born again? Should somebody else teach us to tell that we are born again? The very funny thing that I see, if you are born again, don't say you are born again. Let your neighbor, let your enemy say that so and so is born again. We have to be born again. It is at that point that we could say it is finished. Otherwise, either we are on the starting line or we are not even on the starting line. And as I told you, every word dropped by Jesus from the cross is ours. Is ours. Let us ask that question, whether we could say it is finished, whether we could say that I have fought the good fight, that I ran a good race, crossing the finish line, and I have kept the good faith, to depend on the faith of God. So, my dear friends, it is the duty of every Christian, every believer, to be ready, to be prepared to say that, make that statement what Jesus made from the cross. Let us spend a few moments in silence. Do you live as if Jesus finished the work of salvation? Do you have confidence that God will finish that which he has begun in you? Loving Father, you accomplished that which no other person could do, taking the sin of the world upon your sinless shoulders, taking my sin so that I might receive your forgiveness and life. Gracious Lord, even as we go through our life struggle, enable us, Lord, to complete the tasks entrusted to us. Amen. Let us rise and sing the hymn number 334. I beg your pardon. 374. 374.
So, Lord, and Lord.
Please be seated.
The seventh reading is taken from the book of Luke, chapter 23, verses 44 to 46. The death of Jesus. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. For the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, unto your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. Thanks be to God.
From the word of victory, we move to the final word of contentment. Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Father, into thy hands, into your hands, I commend my spirit. Jesus commence with a prayer, and here ends also with a prayer. This is a very common prayer. We commend our spirits into the hands of our Lord. We commend the spirit of a dying person. And here there is a difference between what Jesus did and what we do. We commend our lives to God out of fear. We feel comfortable commending our lives to the Lord because there is protection and there is comfort. But when Jesus commended his spirit into the hands of his Father, it was an act of contentment. Sometimes when we are so fearful of things around us, we commend our lives, which is perfectly all right. It's not a bad thing. But the difference is that when Jesus commended his spirit, it was an act of contentment. There is a difference between the soul and the spirit, though it is very difficult to differentiate. The spirit appears to be the highest part of our complex being. It is that which particularly distinguishes man from the beasts, and that which links him to God. The spirit is that which God formed within us. Therefore, he called the God of the spirit of all flesh. At death, the spirit returns to God who gave it. Again, the difference is this. Our spirit is taken by God at death, but Jesus commended his spirit to the Father. Jesus gave his spirit with a loud voice. He wanted probably everyone to know that he could not be killed. Jesus was crucified, but was he killed? He died, and that is our belief. Jesus gave his own spirit. He commended his spirit to the Father. And that was a very beautiful prayer. Lord, I commend my spirit. While on the cross, 7 times his lips moved in speech. This is the 7th word that we focus on. 7 is the number of completeness or perfection. 7 is also the number of rest in a finished work. And just as the 7th day was the day of rest and satisfaction, so the 7th utterance of our Savior brings him to the place of rest, the Father's hands. 7 times the dying Savior spoke, and 3 of his utterances concerned men. To one he gave the promise that the man should be with him in paradise. To another he confided his mother. To the spectators he made mention of his thirst. And 4 of his utterances were addressed to God. To the Father he prayed for his murderers. To the Father he uttered his mournful plaint. To the Father he expressed his thirst for the souls. And now, into the hands of the Father, he commends his spirit. Jesus had a very strong communion with his Father. When he was lost in the temple, and when his parents were looking for him, what did he say? He said, "Why are you looking for me? I am doing my Father's business." And in the Sermon on the Mount, he speaks of the 7 speaks of the Father 17 times. During the Passion story, the word Father is found for nearly 45 times. In John 17, which contains what is known as Christ's great high priestly prayer, he speaks to and of the Father 6 more times. On the cross too, he stated his first word with the Father and ends his word, final word, with the same word, Father. Do you know something? His Father and our Father, the same? We worship the same Father. What type of living do we have with that same Father? What type of connection? What type of interaction do we have with that same Father? And how often do we cry out to our Father? How many times do we pray? Should I ask that question or should I not? Do we pray in the morning, noon, and night? Do we teach our children to communicate, to talk with our Heavenly Father? How do we connect ourselves to the Father? Do we approach our God only when we are in need or at all times? Or are we opportunists that we seek God only to fulfill some of our needs? But Jesus was in full communion with his Father. My dear friends, at the very beginning, I said that this is not the story of crucifixion, not the story of death, but the story of love. If you properly analyze it, if you properly think, sit, and reflect, we come to understand that the whole episode, the whole thing that started today and ended the 3rd day is all because of his love for us. It's a love story. It's a love story. Because of that sheer love, Jesus took upon himself the cross. Crucifixion was only a method of his death. So at a deeper level, love is the ultimate cause of Jesus's death. It's all because of his love for us. It's something that we must appreciate, the love of God. It's amazing love. It's amazing love. And whenever there is self-giving love, there is death. In true love, we have to die to our ego. We have to die to our desires. We have to die to our fears and our safety and our security. It involves the complete giving of one's self to another. Those of us who are married do experience this kind of death when we give our spouses priority in their lives. Parents experience this death when they start living not for themselves but for their children. So to love is to risk death, and to refuse death is to deny love. Jesus never denied that love. He never refused. And the greatest and most profound story of love is Jesus's death on the cross. So my dear friends, when we focus on the words of Jesus on the cross, when we look at the crucifix, when we read the story of the crucifixion, the passion, we must ask that one big question. Why? Why did Jesus do this? It's all because of that pure love. All because of that pure love. So the cross points to the intense relationship between love and death, and that is why we call this day Good Friday. That is why we call it the Good Friday. But we have a problem. Unable to forgive, unable to say it is finished, unable to say all the words Jesus had already uttered on the cross. My dear friends, we have been given that free gift, the free gift of life. Let us experience it with the presence of God. We don't have to carry that burden. Our sin have been taken away by our Lord and Savior. And so, as we focus on the cross of Calvary, waiting for the joy of Easter morn, or Easter or resurrection morn, let us bring those words, remember those words, to apply those words into our day-to-day lives, daily life. It's something that we have to do it on a daily basis. Not only read the words, the seven words, only on Good Friday, but that's what we do, no? That's what we do. Only on Good Friday, once a year, we open the scripture, go through all the words. Why not we do it on a daily basis? Because those words speak to us. Those words help us. Those words help us to live a life in the world. Let us carry those words with us and share those words with this perishing world. Let us spend a few moments in silence. Let us ask these questions. Have you put your life beyond this life in God's hands? How do you experience God's salvation through Christ in your life today? How good it is to know that the cross was not the end for Christ, and that is not the end for us. Dear Lord, as you entrusted your spirit into the Father's hands, you did so in anticipation of what was to come. So we reflect upon your death, not in despair, but in hope. Amen. The offertory hymn on the pew sheet.
Song is love unknown, my Savior's love to me, love to the boundless shown that there might lovely be. Oh, whom am I that for my sake my Lord should take frail flesh?
Shall we say together the offertory prayer found on page 4 of our service order? All things come from you, and of your own do give you, Creator and the Lord of the universe, who is forever adored by the holy angels. Out of what you have given, we again give you these gifts, which we present at your holy table, and with them our very lives and service to be taken and service for you, our servant Lord, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Shall we say the Lord's Prayer together? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us remain standing. We may close our eyes. Bow our heads. Remember all the words uttered by Jesus from the cross. Let us reflect upon the word. And take those words into our personal lives and into our corporate lives. Most merciful Father, we remember today the pain and suffering of the cross and all that Jesus was willing to endure so that we could be set free. Your Son Jesus paid the price to offer us the gift of eternal life. Help us, Lord, never to take for granted this huge gift of love on our behalf. Help us, O Father, to be reminded of the cost of it all. And Lord, even as we come together to meditate upon the words uttered by your Son Jesus on the cross, enable us, Lord, we pray, to make these holy words our own. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And unto God's mercy and providential care I commend thee. May the good Lord bless you and keep you. May the good Lord make his face shine upon you, grant you peace and joy. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you now and remain with you always. Amen. Let us sing our final hymn, hymn number 55.
With many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark, adore, humbly and the unbrunt, all music bound, exult. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee. Thy matchless king through all ages.